Here, we are going to look at a commonly used type of gear train called as the reverted gear train, where the input and output shafts are collinear or even coincident. And the power is transmitted from input to output via a third shaft which is parallel to them both. Here is an example of a reverted gear train used in automobiles, where the input shaft shown in red here and the output shaft shown in gray are collinear. The power flows from the engine to the input shaft, and then it takes a detour via this gear pair. So it flows to the lay shaft, and through the lay shaft and this gear engagement, it again comes back to the output shaft. Let us now see some broad steps in the design of such a gearbox. We start by taking the range of gear ratios that we want to achieve, say from 1 to 4, and we are going to divide that into parts. These parts are not arranged in an arithmetic progression, so they are not like 1, 2, 3 and 4, but they are rather arranged in a geometric progression. So each gear ratio is going to be a constant multiple of the previous one. And to find those multiples, I am going to express this 1 and 4, the two extremes, as the powers of the maximum gear ratio, 4. So 1 will be expressed as 4 raised to 0. And 4 will be expressed, of course, as 4 raised to 1. Then I am going to take this maximum power that we want to achieve and divide it into 3 equal parts, because we are going to reach from 1 to 4 in 3 jumps or 3 steps. So this 0 will become 0 upon 3. This 1 will become 3 upon 3. And that will give us the intermediate powers like 1 upon 3 and 2 upon 3. And finally, we will get the gear ratios required. So 4 raised to 1 upon 3 is 1.59 and 4 raised to 2 upon 3 is 2.52. So we have our geometric progression now. Let us see how to incorporate this geometric progression into a gearbox. To understand the idea behind this design, imagine a step pulley over here with 4 steps, say 15, 20, 25 and 30, and another step pulley with now decreasing steps, say 30, 25, 20 and 15. And then if we have a belt between them that can be shifted, then we will get various speed ratios. Of course, here we are using gears, so there is no belt to be shifted because gears engage directly. So instead of the belt, we will shift the gears. And to allow them be shifted, we are going to provide our shaft with some splines. I have shown them in green. So on these splines, I will be able to slide this gear, compound gear EG, to the right or left. Similarly, I'll be able to slide this green gear here to the right or left. Moreover, we have provided some teeth on the surface, on the face of this green gear here, so that it can directly engage with the red gear on the other side. This type of engagement is called as the dog clutch. So now we are going to slide these gears and achieve various ratios. As far as these blue gears are concerned, they are rigidly coupled to the lay shaft. So all of them are rotating at the same speed all the time. So here is our gearbox in neutral, where the power is flowing from the engine to the input shaft and via this engagement to the lay shaft. But none of the gears on the lay shaft is engaging with any gears on the output shaft, and therefore it is not flowing any further or to the wheels. So the engine and wheels are cut off from each other. Then we are going to engage our first gear by sliding this yellow gear to the right. So now the power starts flowing to the output shaft, and you can see there is a reduction here and there is another reduction here, so we get a very high gear ratio. It can be calculated using the number of teeth as shown. Then we are going to engage the second gear. In second gear, we slide this yellow gear to the left, so power starts flowing like this. You can see there is a reduction, but not as much as in the first gear, and the gear ratio has thus reduced to 2.5. In the third gear, we are going to engage these two gears. So now the reduction is even smaller, say 1.6, and finally we are going to go to the top gear. To get the top gear or the fourth gear, we are going to slide this green gear to the left. So using these teeth, the dog clutch, the green and the red gear will directly engage with each other. And in that case, the power is going to flow directly from the input to the output shaft. Of course, in this case, the lathe shaft will continue to rotate because this engagement is there all the time. Have a belt between them that can be shifted, then we will get various speed ratios. Of course, here we are using gears, so there is no belt to be shifted because gears engage directly. So instead of the belt, we will shift the gears, and to allow them be shifted, we are going to provide our shaft with some splines. I have shown them in green. So on these splines, I will be able to slide this gear, compound gear EG, to the right or left. Similarly, I'll be able to slide this green gear here to the right or left. Moreover, we have provided some teeth on the surface, on the face of this green gear here, so that it can directly engage with the red gear on the other side. This type of engagement is called as the dog clutch. So now we are going to slide these gears and achieve various ratios. As far as these blue gears are concerned, they are rigidly coupled to the lathe shaft. So all of them are rotating at the same speed all the time. So here is our gearbox in neutral, where the power is flowing from the engine to the input shaft and via this engagement to the lathe shaft. But none of the gears on the lathe shaft is engaging with any gears on the output shaft, and therefore it is not flowing any further or to the wheels. So the engine and wheels are cut off from each other. Then we are going to engage our first gear by sliding this yellow gear to the right. So now the power starts flowing to the output shaft, and you can see there is a reduction here and there is another reduction here, so we get a very high gear rate. Let us now see some broad steps in the design of such a gearbox. We start by taking the range of gear ratios that we want to achieve, say from 1 to 4, and we are going to divide that into parts. These parts are not arranged in an arithmetic progression, so they are not like 1, 2, 3 and 4, but they are rather arranged in a geometric progression. So each gear ratio is going to be a constant multiple of the previous one. And to find those multiples, I am going to express this 1 and 4, the two extremes, as the powers of the maximum gear ratio, 4. So 1 will be expressed as 4 raised to 0, and 4 will be expressed, of course, as 4 raised to 1. Then I am going to take this maximum power that we want to achieve and divide it into 3 equal parts, because we are going to reach from 1 to 4 in 3 jumps or 3 steps. So this 0 will become 0 upon 3, this 1 will become 3 upon 3, and that will give us the intermediate powers like 1 upon 3 and 2 upon 3. And finally, we will get the gear ratios required. So 4 raised to 1 upon 3 is 1.59, and 4 raised to 2 upon 3 is 2.52. So we have our geometric progression now. Let us see how to incorporate this geometric progression into a gearbox. To understand the idea behind this design, imagine a step pulley over here with 4 steps, say 15, 20, 25 and 30, and another step pulley with now decreasing steps, say 30, 25, 20 and 15. And then if we here, we are going to look at a commonly used type of gear train called as the reverted gear train, where the input and output shafts are collinear or even coincident. And the power is transmitted from input to output via a third shaft which is parallel to them both. Here is an example of a reverted gear train used in automobiles, where the input shaft shown in red here and the output shaft shown in gray are collinear. The power flows from the engine to the input shaft, and then it takes a detour via this gear pair. So it flows to the lathe shaft, and through the lathe shaft and this gear engagement, it again comes back to the output shaft.